Well, we all have assembled here to listen to Yashika Gupta. I won't come in between you all. For a very long time. But then I thought that since Yashika is here, since Joseph sir is here, Tata Madam is here, first of all, I welcome you all to this small little big talk, okay, on. We've been doing a lot of things, one of such series, we requested Yashika to be here. Just to tell both of you what has been happening in the department, rather in the center. The center has been doing a lot of different kind of activities this time. To begin with, there's a proposal from London School of Economics. We would like to tie up with the center. They would also, yesterday I spoke to some people from the US and this Ambedkar International Center, which has formally accepted that they will be giving us at least one scholarship to and fro airfare, plus a person will be there for about 6 weeks. Similar kind of arrangement to the London School of Economics. The London School of Economics thing is with the government now. We've already sent it to the government. So we are trying to route it through the government. Apart from that, there are a lot of programs that we've been doing in this sector. Though we have a formal syllabus as to what these people are supposed to learn, what update their thoughts, I think whatever new things come up in this new social context, we also try to get those scholars into our bank or meet our students. And basically, we are eager to listen to Yashika today. Apart from this, we had Gaurav Pathania, with whom we did a two-day workshop. We also had Professor Scott Stroud, who came here and who spoke at length about what is the influence of John Dewey on Ambedkar and how the idea of liberty and all of those kind of things comes from Scott more than some other references that have been talked about. In the coming month, we'll be having a screening of some film. Professor Harish Vankhede from JNU will be coming. Professor Neera Chandok from Delhi University. She has come up with a book on secularism. So we're going to discuss that book. And one book by Professor by Professor Rathore. Okay, he is going to talk on the preamble, new book that he has come up with. So these are some of the programs that are lined up on 29th, 30th, and 31st. The 29th, 1st, and 2nd. Of February and March respectively. So these are some of the programs that we'll be doing. Apart from this, of course, your lectures will be there. I invite Yashika and my very dear friend Joseph. Professor Joseph is teaching in the Department of Sociology, has written a lot on society, on, you know, or capitalism. Identity and caste and identity and these kind of things. So it's written. I have requested, it was actually at the last moment, but I requested Joseph to please chair this session. And since Yashika is not from academics, I have asked her to talk to you. Okay, so she'll be sharing her experiences. She'll be talking to you or whatever she is understanding from the society. So it is just like one amongst us. Formerly she was working for Hindustan Times, basically comes from Rajasthan. Okay. Later on, went to Delhi, studied in Delhi, worked for HT for some time, and now she's a freelance journalist in the US. And this book was, you know, very well circulated, and she talks about herself. A lot of criticisms came is, but one thing is there that she's talking about whatever she has experienced, she talks very frankly in this particular book. So I request the chair to thank you.
That's it. I think first we shall listen to Jessica and then I'll talk.
Yeah,
that's great.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming. It's a Saturday, you have better things to do. So thanks for coming and listening to me. You know, thank you for having me here. It's a really big honor. I'm a journalist, I'm not an academic. I didn't even go to grad school till very recently because circumstances were such that I needed to go out and earn and not be in school. And when I did, grad school really opened my mind, as I'm sure you know when you are at a university. But even then, I was not in touch with Ambedkar. I thought I didn't even know about Ambedkar in a deep way, and it was a conscious choice. I subconsciously, I chose not to know more about Ambedkar because what I was trying to do, and if any of you read my work or are familiar, I was trying to hide my caste. And I grew up lying about being Dalit, or not just lying about it, escaping from the fact that I was a Dalit person. And I'm not just a Dalit person, and I know we, outside of this room, outside of us Ambedkarites, we don't talk about the differentiation so much, but I'm from the Valmiki, untouchable caste. And till two generations ago, people in my family, my own grandparents, went to do the manual scavenging and cleaning work. And when I look back at it as a journey in terms of, you know, my grandmother was going and cleaning people's bathrooms and I'm standing in front of you talking about my story, it's you can say that the story in our family has come quite a long way. So before I get into that, I just want to ask, who among here, among us, has hidden their caste, ever? You have. Are you from, where did you grow up?
Mumbai.
You grew up in Mumbai. And everyone else is out and proud, very proud to be Dalit. I'm so jealous of everybody here. Because, what's your name?
Shraddha.
So Shraddha and I probably understand that when you live with this lie, it becomes a burden. And in the book, I describe it like carrying a dead body around. Because what happens is, every time someone comes to you and asks you, because in Rajasthan, and if you have visited the north, or if you're familiar with Rajasthan politics, or Madhya Pradesh politics, or Uttar Pradesh, caste is really up in the forefront, and so is it in Maharashtra, but here people are able to draw some sort of pride from it. But especially for my family, when two generations ago we were going in cleaning, for us to be able to say we are out and proud in Dalit.
Sorry, a little bit of Hindi.
Haanti. Bol achhe se aake. To ye jaake bolna ki hum log Dalit hai aur openly iske bare mein baat karna bahut mushkil tha. To tab जब बचपन से ही मुझे सिखाया गया दैट आप छोटे होते हैं तो स्कूल में आपसे एक क्वेश्चन पूछा जाता है कि आज स्कूल में आपने क्या किया, क्या सीखा, व्हाट वाज द होमवर्क. माय मॉम, वो मुझसे पूछती थी, आज आपसे किसी ने आपकी कास्ट पूछी या नहीं? और अगर आपकी किसी ने आपकी कास्ट पूछी है तो आपने क्या जवाब दिया? एंड पहले या तो मुझे याद नहीं है अच्छे से और आई डोंट रिकॉल करेक्टली, बट आई यूज टू रिमेंबर बीइंग वेरी एंग्री एट हर, being 5 or 6, and be feeling really angry कि क्यों मुझे ये बोला जा रहा है कि मैं जो मैं नहीं हूँ वो मैं बोलूँ. और तब when you're that at that age, you don't realize the what it's teaching you about the world. What it is teaching you is that आप जो हो that is not good enough, आप जो हो that's not worthy, that's not valid, इसलिए आप अपने बारे में झूठ बोलें ताकि लोग आपको accept कर सकें. नहीं तो अगर आप अपने बारे में सच्चाई बताएंगे then you will get discriminated. And what that tells you from a really young age is that you're unequal, that you're not the same. And especially growing up in Rajasthan, मुझे ये लगा कि जो है जैसे caste system के बारे में हमें सिखाया जाता है that Brahmins and Kshatriyas etc. एंड देन दलित एंड देन वाल्मीकिज. तो वो मेरे लिए रियलिटी बन चुकी थी. दैट वॉज अ फैक्ट ऑफ माई लाइफ एंड आई ग्रो अप विद इट थिंकिंग दैट अगर किसी को सही में मेरे बारे में पता चल गया देन दे आर गोइंग टू रिजेक्ट मी और दे आर गोइंग टू नॉट टॉक टू मी. बट एंड व्हेन यू आर अ चाइल्ड आपका वर्ल्ड व्यू बहुत ही लिमिटेड होता है. तो आप ये नहीं सोचते हो कि क्या आगे दुनिया क्या सोचेगी. आप ये सोचते हो कि मेरे फ्रेंड्स क्या सोचेंगे, मेरे टीचर्स क्या सोचेंगे, क्या मुझे अच्छे मार्क्स मिलेंगे या नहीं, क्या वो मेरे को प्रैक्टिकल्स में कम मार्क्स देंगे, विच आर एक्चुअल इश्यूज दैट दलित स्टूडेंट्स फेस. एंड आई रिमेम्बर फीलिंग लाइक जब मेरी मम्मी पूछती थी कि क्या आपने क्या बोला आज आपको ये, आपने बोला कि आप पराशर हो या नहीं, बिकॉज हमारा द अज्यूम वन ऑफ आर अज्यूम फैमिली नेम्स इज फ्रॉम माई मदर साइड इज पराशर विच इज अ ब्राह्मण नेम. तो आई दीज आर माई अर्लीस्ट मेमोरीज ऑफ जैसे आप पूछते हैं कि आप व्हाट डू यू रिमेम्बर फर्स्ट. आई रिमेम्बर लाइंग अबाउट माई कास्ट. That's what I grew up with. And I grew up thinking that, like I said, that I'm never going to be equal to a Brahmin person. Because agar unse pucha ja raha hai ki aap kya ho, to wo to bahut aasani se bol dete hain. Class mein mujhe yaad bhi hai discussions hote the. Tum kya ho? Tum Marwari hai, hum to Rajput hai, Rajasthan mein bahut sare Rajput rehte hain. Aur they used to say it with this sort of pride. Aur mujhse jab pucha jata tha, to I used to say ki mujhe nahi pata. मुझे अच्छे से पता था बट आई डिडंट इवन वांट टू लाई. क्योंकि अगर हम ये बोलते हैं कि मुझे नहीं पता, जैसे प्रोग्रेसिव फैमिलीज का होता है, सवर्णा प्रोग्रेसिव फैमिलीज बोलते हैं, हम तो इतने प्रोग्रेसिव, इतने कास्ट ब्लाइंड है कि हमें पता ही नहीं हमारी कास्ट क्या है. बट एक्चुअली इट्स ओनली मोस्टली दलित पीपल हु मोस्टली आर अवेयर बट आर बीइंग फोर्स टू हाइड एंड लिव विद दिस गिल्ट. एंड आई रिमेंबर व्हेन आई वाज 15 इयर्स ओल्ड आई वाज सिक ऑफ लाइंग अबाउट माय कास्ट. आई ग्रू अप विद दिस होल आइडिया ऑफ शेम, होल आइडिया ऑफ गिल्ट. कि पहली बात तो आप झूठ बोल रहे हो, आप क्या हो. हर बार आपको ये लगता है कि किसी को पता चल गया तो फिर क्या होगा, व्हाट्स गोइंग टू हैपन इफ समबडी फाइंड्स आउट. एंड ऑन टॉप ऑफ दैट आई यूज टू वंडर दैट एम आई इवन गुड इनफ नो मैटर व्हाट आई डू. आप कितना भी पढ़ाई कर लो, आप कुछ भी कर लो, विल आई एवर बी इक्वल टू अ ब्राह्मण पर्सन. एंड दीज आर थिंग्स दैट आई कैन ओनली टॉक अबाउट टॉक अमंग आवर पीपल एज अंबेडकर राइट्स. बाहर जाके इफ आई टॉक अबाउट दिस दिल से क्या तुम ड्रामा कर रहे हो, ड्रामेटिक बातें, तुम मन घड़म. बट दिस इज रियली दिस वॉज द रियलिटी आई ग्रू अप विद. एंड आई रिमेंबर बीइंग 15 इयर्स ओल्ड एंड तब मुझे लगा कि शायद मेरे पेरेंट्स एग्जैजरेट करते हैं, शायद ऐसा नहीं है कि सही में कोई ऐसा थोड़ी होगा, कौन डिस्क्रिमिनेट करता है. आई वॉज इफेक्टिवली लाइक एंड हम लोग ने इतना अच्छा एक वो क्रिएट कर लिया था इल्यूजन कि हम अपर कास्ट हैं. तो आई कैन नॉट फेस डायरेक्ट डिस्क्रिमिनेशन टू देम. एंड आई रिमेंबर बीइंग 15 एंड आई वेंट होम टू वन ऑफ माय फ्रेंड्स हाउस और उनके पेरेंट्स ने की पूछ जैसे पूछते हैं आपसे कि आपके पेरेंट्स क्या करते हैं ये वो. तो फिर उसको राजस्थान में तो सेकंड क्वेश्चन यही रहता है आपकी कास्ट क्या है. तो मैंने बता दिया कि मैंने सोचा कि अब की बार बस बहुत हो गया, आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू लाई एनी मोर, आई हैव बीन लाइंग ऑल माई लाइफ, आई एम 15 ईयर्स ओल्ड. That's it. This was my little rebellion. When you're a teenager, you want to rebel. And I said, "Niche dekhe." And imagine I'm sitting and on this like round table. यहाँ पे parents बैठे हैं, यहाँ पर मेरी दोस्त बैठी है और यहाँ पे मैं बैठी हूँ. और मैंने नीचे देखते हुए मुझे पता था कि I'm doing this radical act of accepting a truth that I'd never said in public before. तो मैंने नीचे देख के बोला धीरे से कि हम ऐसी हैं. कास्ट का नाम भी मुझसे लिया नहीं जाता था उस टाइम. भंगी बोलना तो बहुत बड़ी बात है. टू से दैट आई एम अ भंगी पर्सन वाज लाइक कॉलिंग माय सेल्फ अ स्लर. सो आई जस्ट सेड हम एससी हैं. तो एंड आई रिमेंबर इट फेल्ट लाइक अ बॉम्ब हैड डिफ्यूज्ड इन द रूम. इट वाज एब्सोल्यूट साइलेंस एंड आई रिमेंबर दैट मोमेंट रियली वेल. एंड आफ्टर अ फ्यू मिनट्स उनके पेरेंट्स ने बोला नहीं हम तो बड़े प्रोग्रेसिव हैं, ऐसे तो कोई बात नहीं है, आप बहुत अच्छी बात है, आप ऐसी हो तो क्या हुआ, हम ऐसे कोई मानते नहीं है कास्ट में. तो आई वाज लाइक आई नो दैट्स व्हाट दे सेइंग बट आई नो दैट्स नॉट व्हाट दे फील. एंड आई न्यू आई हैड डन समथिंग रॉन्ग. आई न्यू दैट मेरे को जो नहीं बोलना चाहिए था वो मैंने बोल दिया. एंड आई डिडंट नो व्हाट द कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस वर. सो आई वेंट बैक होम एंड द नेक्स्ट डे यूज्ड टू टेक सेम बस टू स्कूल. एंड आई सॉ दिस गर्ल, आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू टेक हर नेम, स्टार्ट्स विद एस. आई वाज लाइक हे एस, व्हाट्स गोइंग ऑन. उन्होंने मेरी तरफ देखा और ऐसे की नज़र में ऐसे पार करके ऐसे निकल गई. दैट आई डिडंट इवन एग्जिस्ट.
that I wasn't a person anymore. Suddenly, from being a friend, a person that she was talking to, spent time with, I suddenly became invisible. Or फिर उसके अंदर कि what's up, hi, और फिर वो ऐसे ही मुझसे दूसरी तरफ मुंह करके खड़ी हो गई बस में. And that I remember that moment so vividly, and it dawned on me पहली बार कि I can never tell anybody my caste. क्योंकि अगर मैं बताऊंगी किसी को तो यही होगा. And that's how I, like, after 15, then I went to school, graduated. School mein bhi yeh conversation rehta tha ki tum to reservation, mujhe nahi because, you know, I never talked about it. But other people said, tum reservation loge to tumhare ko kya padhne ki zarurat hai. Tumhare ko to aise hi marks mil jayenge, tumko to aasani se aise hi entry mil sakti hai. That's why in school exams, I never availed for reservation. बिकॉज आई थॉट जैसे काफ़ी हमारे दलित लोग सोचते हैं कि नहीं हम तो अपने मेरिट को प्रूव करके दिखाएंगे बिकॉज लाइक अवेलिंग एफर्मेटिव एक्शन एज इफ इट्स अपोज टू बीइंग मेरिट हैविंग मेरिट एज इफ इफ यू टेल द वर्ल्ड दैट यू आर दैट पर्सन देन यू सडनली स्टॉप हैविंग मेरिट आई इंटरनलाइज दैट आइडिया सो डीपली कि मुझे लगा कि नहीं मैं अपने टैलेंट पे प्रूव करके बताऊँगी और मुझे ये हैंड आउट नहीं चाहिए एंड Think about this language that I was telling myself. This is the language that upper caste society or Savarna society tells us. And eventually when I went to college, I remember asking my mom, ki main kya tick karun? You know, should I check the reservation box or not? She's like, wait, I didn't grow up with a lot of money. So she said, kam se kam tumhe scholarships mil jayenge. And I did that. And I remember those 3 years I lived in fear. Ki kahin agar mere classmates ko pata chal gaya. And St. Stephen's mein. It's one of the most elite colleges in the country. वहाँ पे ऐसे बोलते हैं कि caste blind है, caste neutral है. Nobody talks about caste there because वहाँ elections नहीं होते as compared to Hindu or Hansraj or other DU colleges where elections are very much run on caste lines. St. Stephen's doesn't have that. So you can kind of escape your caste. But even there, I lived in this mortal fear that if somebody found out, I would stop having friends. These people that I had come to love and adore and be close to wouldn't be with me anymore. And even after that, I graduated. I went into journalism, and I could have taken anything else. मैं कुछ भी choose कर सकती थी, political journalism, social journalism, but I chose fashion. I chose to write about fashion and culture, and I want to talk about this because I want to tell you कि हम जो choices करते हैं life में They are so governed by what our caste is and what we are trying to do with that caste, especially in my case. I chose fashion because I thought ki agar main fashion pe likhungi to us wo world itna elite hai aur itna insular hai ki wahan par agar koi pahunch gaya to uska to caste apne aap hi assume kiya jata hai ki aap upper caste hi hoge. Because this is also this question ki dalit dekhne mein hote kaise? Do they dress well? Do they look a certain way? How do we come across? So I thought that will be my protection, that will be my cover. And I kept writing about fashion, and my experiences with the industry were exactly what I thought they were. Everybody said, even if the question came up, they said, yeah, I'm also, you know, like, we are very Brahmin, or we are very this, or we are very that. Koi baat nahi karta tha, but it was automatically assumed. Only time this question came up when I went to get a house in Delhi. And the landlord said, आप तो अपर कास्ट ही हो गए. And I said, हाँ अगर आपको लगता है and if I've been able to convince you for this long that I'm an upper caste person, then I'm going to say yes. Because I'm not going to, with everything else that is going on, not having money, not having financial support, not having family support, I'm not going to bring this one more thing on myself. So I'm just going to go with the convenient narrative. And I remember अभी कुछ दिन में आई बिन हियर फॉर 2 वीक्स मेरे काफ़ी डिस्कशंस रहे लोगों से एंड जर्नलिस्ट से भी. उन्होंने बोला कि आपसे ही ये क्वेश्चन क्यों पूछते थे सब. आपने काफ़ी बात की इस बारे में कि लोग मुझसे पूछते हैं मेरी कास्ट के, हमसे तो कभी नहीं पूछा. एंड दैट रियली मेड मी वंडर कि एम आई मेकिंग दिस अप, क्या नहीं पूछते लोगों से. एंड आई थॉट मे बी देयर इज समथिंग अबाउट मी कि लोगों को लग जाते हैं कि ये झूठ बोल रही है. बट एक्चुअली आई रियलाइज नॉट वेरी मच लेटर दैट वो क्वेश्चन उनसे भी पूछा जाता है पर उनका आंसर इतना साफ और सटीक और क्लियर होता है कि उनके पास कुछ हाइड करने के लिए नहीं होता है. एंड दैट्स नॉट समथिंग दे रिमेंबर बिकॉज टू डेज लेटर आई वेंट टू दिस साड़ी शॉप विद माई मॉम एंड वी वर बाइंग साड़ीज एंड द गाय अगेन इन जयपुर आस्क्ड मी आप तो राजपूत हो. And that question came again just 2 days later after all the journalists I met were saying, why don't we ever get asked this question? Because even if you do, that's not important or relevant to you. And you have a clear answer. Your last name, whether whatever upper caste last name it is, usme aapko pata chal jata hai ki aapke paas kuch chupane ke liye nahi hai. Because that's how memory works, right? If it's not something that's going to stand up to you, you will not remember it. But for people like me, especially people like me, who are hiding our caste, these experiences are going to be formative experiences of our lives. They will teach us how to deal with the world later on. And, you know, from there, I mean, I talked a little bit about Ambedkar earlier. Mere kuch relatives hain, dur ke, who are Ambedkarites. And I remember walking into their room one day, in Uttar Pradesh, और उनके बड़ा सा अम्बेडकर पोस्टर था. And I've seen now how people react to Ambedkar with good reason. Like, you know, उनकी whole existence is based on what Ambedkar did. And absolutely understood. But I remember जब मैंने पहली बार अम्बेडकर की वो बड़ी फोटो देखी थी, I was filled with terror. And the reason I was filled with terror, or the reason I was filled with fear, was because अगर किसी को पता चल गया that I like Ambedkar, then they will find out that I'm hiding my caste. And this is not just my narrative. This is something that I've heard from so many people. So many people who've written to me ever since I came out as a Dalit person, ever since I got my book published, said that they don't want to associate with Ambedkar because they are worried that this is going to out them. And whether that's right or wrong is, of course, a subjective issue. But it's completely the fault of the society that we live in that makes us feel ashamed of the one person who's ever stood up for our rights. And that's one of the reasons I did not read Ambedkar till I was 30. And it's obvious, right? I mean, I was just talking earlier before the session. You might remember this incident in Maharashtra mein shayad hua tha, jab this 17-year-old kid was listening to Ambedkar's ringtone on his phone, right? Yeah, Shani, right? And upper caste savar log ne bola ki band karo isko, kya bakwas hai. तो उन्होंने बंद नहीं किया और उनको इतना खराब लगा कि दिस गाय वाज टेकिंग सो मच प्राइड इन हिज आइडल दैट दे किल्ड हिम टू डेथ दे बीट हिम टू डेथ एंड दैट्स द प्राइस दैट दलित्स ऑफन पे फॉर सम टाइम्स एसोसिएटिंग विद अम्बेडकर एंड दैट्स व्हाई इट्स टोटली अंडरस्टैंडेबल अगर आप में से कई लोग सोचे ये क्या पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू है ऐसे कैसे सोच सकते हो आपकी आप अम्बेडकर के साथ एसोसिएट नहीं करोगे. And that's valid. But I think we also have to criticize the system that makes us feel this way. Why are some of us so ashamed or terrified of associating with this amazing person who stood for our rights, who did everything he could, who basically gave, especially me, this life that I have today? And that's, I think that's where the criticism should be directed. Instead of at individuals as well. And I'm sure a lot of criticism is directed often even within the Dalit community about why are they passing? Kyun aapko jab maine bataya tha ki I'm coming out as Dalit, to logon ne bola kya zarurat hai aapko chupa ke rehne ki? Aapko kyun laga ki aapko chupa ke rehna padta hai? Because I think first thing we need to do is understand ki har kisi ki situation same nahi hoti hai. We are about 1/4 of the country's population Dalit Bahujans milakar. And STs as well. We're not coming from the same background, the same ideological viewpoints, the same class backgrounds or gender backgrounds. And there is intersectionality. So agar hum expect karenge ki har koi ek tarike se behave kare, har koi same point of view rakhe, so that's a little unfair. And that's why I felt like when I was revealing my identity, I needed to create a new term for it. That's why I called it coming out as well. And I also wanted to create a term for what I was going through. So I'm sure many of us are familiar with African Americans who are light-skinned, who pass as white people if they can. And they do that because that is a convenient life for them. Unko lagta hai ki इस यू नो दिस सोसाइटी जो हमारे लिए इतने अगेंस्ट है कि वो किसी भी दे डोंट वांट अस टू सर्वाइव फॉरगेट वो हमारे को एडवांस तो करने ही नहीं देना चाहते वो हमें जीने भी नहीं देना चाहते तो अगर उस सोसाइटी में हम लोग कैसे भी करके वी कैन मेक लाइफ ईजियर फॉर आवरसेल्व्स तो हम वो करेंगे और आई थिंक एंड आई ट्रूली फील आई एम नॉट स्पीकिंग यू नो आई एम ओनली स्पीकिंग फॉर माई सेल्फ नॉट स्पीकिंग फॉर एनीबडी एल्स बट आई थिंक एज एन इंडिविजुअल वी हैव द राइट टू चूज व्हाट्स बेस्ट फॉर अस एंड आई वांट टू टेल यू अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट व्हाट इट फेल्ट लाइक when I first confronted the reality of what I was going through. So I told you, I grew up thinking that I'm unequal. As हम लोग बहुत सारे सोचते हैं कि Brahmins अगर बोल रहे हैं वो हमसे बड़े हैं तो होंगे ही. And it was only until I went to Colombia in 2014 where I learned about systems of oppression and discrimination and it's so heartening that I'm in this university aur yahan pe ye sab baatein itni freely hoti hain jab even in the college that I went to hame ye sab cheeze batayi nahi jati hain I did science we were taught about atoms and you know core particles and quantum physics nobody taught me about discrimination and how the system is built to keep a few people out and I think that's something we need to address as well where is that education right and only when I went to Colombia I learned ki just like white supremacy exists in a paradigm that is created to keep black people out to keep people of color out similarly caste supremacy is created to keep Dalits untouchable people out and I was still thinking about these ideas then I was in this class for I think it was feminist theory class wahan pe a module where we had to discuss our own identities keep this talk about your experience with identity and if at all any trauma that you faced with it and I remember there were like these amazing black students and queer students and latino students so sab apni identities ke bare mein baat kar rahe the ki because of the color of their skin because of where they're from because of their background unki discrimination ke sath kya experiences rahe and at that time I had not talked about being a Dalit person or the life that I had grown up in or the inequality that I had experienced. And I remember thinking ki, should I even talk about castes? Kyunki what I'm going through, that is nothing compared to what they're going through. Because, you know, sometimes you get into this mindset, especially if you've read about trauma, you might be familiar with this idea that somebody who's traumatized always feels that their trauma is lesser than the other person's trauma. Because you feel that I haven't gone through enough. You can read about like people who've gone through horrific experiences with rape and violence. You'll say, but I haven't gone through enough. I think the other person's trauma is more than mine. Because that's how we experience trauma. And then I thought, ki mere paas aur kuch to batane ke liye hai nahi, because this is my identity and I think this is a safe space and I can talk about it. And I did. And I talked about how I was pretending and I was passing as an upper caste person and how it's fine that if there are Brahmins who are superior, maybe that's the worldview, but I'm trying to challenge it. And for the first time, waha unke faces pe I saw shock and horror. Jaise yahan pe if we talk about caste, maine kuch friends ko bataya tha jaane se pehle Colombia, and they had acceptance. They were sweet and they were nice. They didn't discriminate against me. But these people, these foreign kids, international kids from all across the world, on their faces I saw shock and horror and the actual anger that I should have felt about my own identity for so long, and I hadn't. And then it was like a mirror that I needed to see much long ago what I was seeing when I was 28 years old. And that really shook me. That's when I realized ki shayad jo mera belief system hai and the way I think about myself and the way I think about caste, maybe it's completely wrong. Maybe this is not, maybe just what Hinduism has told us is not real. And that's for the first time I started questioning it. And as many of you might be familiar, the final band-aid was ripped off for me when I read Rohit's letter. Tab-tab, I was still thinking about what I can do, किस तरह से आई कैन नेविगेट बिकॉज मेरा एक फियर ये भी था कि एज अ जर्नलिस्ट अगर मैंने बता दिया कि आई एम अ दलित जर्नलिस्ट तो क्या मुझे काम मिलेगा क्या न्यूज़पेपर्स विल will they still give me bylines? Ho sakta hai mereko bylines hi dena band kar de ho. Because it happens to a lot of Dalit journalists in newsrooms where they are told ki tum sirf reservation cover karo na yaar, tum sirf election cover karo, tumhe aur kya cover karne ki zarurat hai. There are so many experiences I have heard from people when they talk about that. Or in a lot of regional newsrooms they say, acha aap kis us gaon se ho, aapki wo caste hai to hum aapko hire hi nahi kar sakte. So I didn't want to face any of that, and then I read Rohit's letter, and that really shifted something for me. And that's also something that, you know, people in the community have said, he, why does that mean so much to you? Well, because not just to me, to so many other Bahujan people, unki life badal gayi. Maine usse pehle, I had not read a Dalit person writing in English before. ऐसा नहीं है कि ऐसा हुआ नहीं है दलित पीपल हैव नॉट रिटन इन इंग्लिश आई जस्ट हैडन्ट रेड इट बिकॉज नथिंग हैड बीन सो आउट एंड सो प्राउड एंड सो दलित एंड सो ब्यूटिफुल इन मेन स्ट्रीम डिस्कोर्स लाइक इन द सेम वे इट वॉज अ वायरल लेटर इट वॉज नॉट अ बुक एनीबडी कुड रीड इट यू नीडेड 5 मिनट्स टू एंगेज विद इट एंड इट रियली शिफ्टेड समथिंग इनसाइड मी एंड दैट्स व्हेन आई रियलाइज्ड एंड आई टॉक्ड अबाउट दिस बिफोर सो इफ इट्स बोरिंग आई एम सॉरी That's when I realized ki Rohit came from a really different class background, much worse than mine. And he was in Hyderabad and he had all the reason to hide his caste. He didn't have to be the person he was, being an activist. Wo bhi chupa ke reh sakte the jaise main reh rahi thi. But he didn't choose to do that. He chose to fight. And he had to pay the ultimate price. And I think that really changed me in a way when I thought ki theek hai, my life has been quite traumatic so far, but abhi I'm at Columbia and what am I doing with this? I'm a journalist. How can I do my job, which is to bring Dalit stories to the forefront? What can I do to maybe contribute in some way? Because I've been in HD, I've been at Asian Age. जब भी आप कोई दलित narrative के बारे में बात करते थे तो comments I used to always read. As a journalist, I have a really bad habit to read all the toxic comments. Comments were all about reservation, या तुम seat grab कर रहे हो जैसे मैं भी सोच रही थी पहले तुम seat grab कर रहे हो तुम सरकार के पैसे पे बढ़ रहे हो तुम्हें हैंड आउट दिया जा रहा है and I was really sick of this toxic narrative, especially after reading Rohit's letter, which was so soulful. I thought that we needed to create a space that was just our own. I didn't know those spaces existed, by the way. They did, RDI and you know, Ambedkar's caravan. All those spaces were already there. But I thought I wanted to create a space that could just be our own, that could be free from negativity, toxicity. This is a safe space where we could come and talk about our traumas, where we could support each other, we could share pride, where we could even build pride, maybe, you know, in our own identity. And that's why I started this Tumblr called Documents of Dalit Discrimination, where I invited people to just talk about and send me their stories, and I was just going to put them as it is, and we could just create this template where a new kind of Dalit narrative would emerge. And I want to caveat this by saying that I was not involved with the movement. As you know, I was not even out as Dalit, and I was not aware of what was going on. I just saw what was around me, but I'd been enough in mainstream media to know that there was nothing visibly there that I could access easily. So I just wanted to create a safe space that somebody who was thinking to do what Rohit did, maybe they could see this and draw some strength that there are so many other people like us. And that's how that Tumblr was born and the book came about and all of that. But what that did for me was it made me realize that there are so many Dalit stories that need to be told. There's not just one kind of story. There are millions of Dalit narratives. There are as many Dalit narratives as there are Dalits. And each of them are worthy and important and deserve to be told. And I remember the first time that I felt like I was out and proud was at Barnard University. After I had finished, after I was still writing my book, the note was being read everywhere. And I think North America Ambedkar Association invited me to just do a small paper, something like this. Every year they have a huge conference in New York. So for Ambedkar's 125th anniversary, they organize this conference. And I didn't know what to expect, so I just prepared like a paper as a journalist. And I went there. And it was there that for the first time I experienced what Dalit Pride was like. Everybody out there was open. Everybody out there was wearing blue, the Ambedkar blue. People were so proud of who they were. They were addressing each other as with Jai Bheem. मैंने तो उससे पहले जय भीम बोला भी नहीं था कभी. It was at that conference or that day that I realized what being free looks like. And when I went on stage that day and I read that paper, I got this overwhelming sense of being accepted because everybody knew who I was. तब तक I was in New York. I'd written my letter. बाकी सब हो गया था. Twitter पे सब मुझे काफी कुछ बोल रहे थे गलत. कि क्यों तुमने किया टेंशन ये वो. एंड आई वॉज ओनली फीलिंग वेरी नेगेटिव बट दैट वॉज माई फर्स्ट पॉजिटिव एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ बींग आउट एंड बींग अ दलित पर्सन. एंड आई थिंक इट मेड मी फील फ्री इन अ वे दैट आई नेवर हैड बिफोर. इट मेड मी फील एक्सेप्टेड बिकॉज एवरीबडी वॉज देयर. एवरीबडी वॉज रूटिंग फॉर ईच अदर. देयर वॉज सो मच सपोर्ट, सो मच सॉलिडैरिटी इन दैट रूम. And then I realized the power that we have, the power that we have in our identity and what it means to be out and proud and how important it is for us to tell the world that we are Dalit. And that's why, you know, politics aside, just what it means to an individual to see other people who are just like them and who are not scared, who are not ashamed, who are not terrified of themselves, who don't think they're not worthy, who think they are worthy. And I saw that with Rohit, and I saw that with these people who I met in New York for the first time. And it kind of made me a complete person. And I will forever be thankful for that. And even beyond that, I just want to add, I learned that Dalit voices are really important. And that's why we need to keep talking. So, you know, I've done a bit of work I've been in media. And even with the book, I went and did a lot of research. And what I realized was that the way media looks at Dalit narratives is completely twisted. Some of you might be old enough to remember, 2006 major anti-reservation protests were there, AIIMS se jo start with it. Media covered it. And print media was at least giving, like, trying to do an unbiased kind of reporting. But television media kya kar rahi thi? AIIMS ke reporters ne badi badi jhaadus de rakhi thi. And what they were doing was they were sweeping the floor and saying ki hum nahi Dalit hai. Kyunki tum reservation bada rahe ho to bhai hum to Dalit ho gaye. And that's how it works. Television media was broadcasting those images and we can say enough about TV channels. So aaj to matlab 2020 mein wo baat hi karne layak nahi hai. But 2006 mein it was still shocking. Because TV channels presented those images without context. उन्होंने ना कुछ बताया कि क्यों ये गलत है, ना उन्होंने ये headlines दिखाई, but they just show those images 24/7. And the idea that Dalits don't have merit kind of cemented back then. And they also, right in AIIMS, there were pro-reservation protests that were happening. AIIMS administration ने उनको जगह तक नहीं दी, जबकि anti-reservation protests के लिए उन्होंने tents लगाए, ACs लगाए, fans लगाए. So that's the kind of institutional discrimination that takes place. And the reason I'm telling you this is because that kind of vacuum that Indian media has left with Dalit narratives is now being filled with Dalit media. And I call it Dalit media because these are small scale publications, RTI, Dalit Camera, and a lot of individuals on Twitter and Facebook who are kind of thought leaders, who are constantly talking about their stories, who analyze and process these incidents that constantly happen. And you know, as we know, hamari atrocities ki kami to hai nahi. Kuch na kuch incident hamesha hi hote rehta hai. So these people are really analyzing and giving us a way to think, and they're real thought leaders. And what I want to say is, as Dalits, of course, so many of us are proud here, but we should also use our voices. Because one kind of story is not enough. We need to talk about each of our stories and put them online so that a multi-dimensional narrative can be created. Because when I came out, people said, "Aap to Dalit lagte hi nahi ho." Abhi bhi log mujhe bolte, Dalits bolte. कि आप दलित नहीं लगते तो मुझे कैसा लगना चाहिए. आई एम अ दलित वुमन सो आई शुड बी वेरी हैप्पी एंड लुक लाइक काइंड ऑफ विक्टिमाइज मे बी नॉट टेक प्राइड इन माई वर्क देन आई विल लुक लाइक द इमेजिन दलित वुमन. बट इफ आई एम प्राउड ऑफ वॉट आई डू एंड वॉट आई हैव अचीव्ड देन आई एम नॉट द राइट काइंड ऑफ दलित वुमन. एंड दैट्स वाई आर स्टोरीज ईच ऑफ आर स्टोरीज आर रियली इम्पॉर्टेंट. We need to write, we need to be on social media, we need to change the narrative. Because only when we do that is mainstream media going to pay attention to us. And that's why our voices are really important. That's all I have to say. Jebby.
Introduce you, I mean, but still I want you to introduce her once again. Now she's already introduced her. This is for the formal interview. Yeah, sure. There is a reason why I want her to introduce her. Come.
Journalist, the writer who I am in complete awe of. So, in your prologue, you said that Rohit helped you to, you know, accept your identity. It was you who helped me to accept my identity out in public. So,
thank you.
And listening to you today, it was really special. Actually, I texted Mridul sir really last minute to arrange your lecture. So, thank you, Mridul sir, for doing it.
So we'll take a few questions.
Questions?
Questions, comments? Anything is better. Yeah.
I have just one question. Okay. Basically, even I'm talking as a professor. I just have one thought in my mind. Like, I am born and brought up in Mumbai. Okay. So you're, frankly speaking, I have never hidden my past, always with a lot of pride. Even in my own cabin where I sit, I have Ambedkar's photo as well as Buddha's photo in my room. Okay, but Mumbaikars, I don't feel so they think this much about the discrimination, but yes, people from small towns, I really feel that they have that kind of, you know, thing. Because when I did my schooling, I never faced anything. I did my graduation, my college, I never faced anything. I did my MBA, I never faced anything. But now, since I'll not take the name of my college, because I don't want to. So now in this case, where I'm working in an MBA college, yeah, there while working, I saw like certain people saying that, oh, she's Buddhist. So, but I never thought what is harm in that and what is wrong in that. And you know what, let me tell you one thing, that I take a lot of pride in saying that, because I'm far better off, you know, rated, high rated faculty in terms of my feedback as to many so-called Brahmins and Marathas. So I feel a lot of pride in that. So I keep myself motivated that way. But do you really feel so that it has to do with the place that you come from? Because I don't think so. Mumbaikars, no, I can't even generalize because I have not conducted a research here. But so far, I have never faced this. So is it something that it has to do with the place that you come from, the small towns that you come from? And still, it prevails? Because the people who stay in this, in my college, they are basically from small towns. So when they see, they come to Mumbai, they feel that they have come to New York, Manhattan area. Okay, so that is what I feel. So do you feel that this is something, an important criteria?
I do think, and thanks for that question. I'm so happy that you're able to be proud. And obviously, merit has nothing to do with caste location. You know, it's, I have no doubt that you're amazing at what you do. And congratulations for that. But I don't think it's a small town versus big town issue. It's not an urban versus real issue. It has everything to do with the awareness and how people are around us, especially in Maharashtra with Ambedkar movement, and correct me if I'm wrong, is really strong. But places like Rajasthan, even in Jaipur, which is a so-called big town, capital city, discrimination is extremely rampant. And you know, Hyderabad University was a big town university. Institutional discrimination was present there. Delhi is a big town. Ames is a big town college. We've all read Professor Thorat's study about how AIM students were discriminating against new quota students by making them sit on the floor, ragging practices, asking them to chant 10 reasons why they don't belong here. So they were kind of instituting this idea that if you are a reservation student, if you're a quota student, you're not good enough, you don't have a right to be here. And these are all issues are happening in urban areas, in large towns. Manual scavenging happens in large towns, and you see, like Bangalore, a kid just died, a 17-year-old. So, you know, discrimination looks different in different areas based on the political awareness in that locality or in that state or in that city. But I think discrimination persists pretty much everywhere. How we experience it might be different, but it doesn't go away.
Intensity varies.
Intensity can definitely vary. How we experience it can vary, but institutionally it will stay, and it's just how lucky one is, I suppose.
Thank you so much.
Actually, first I'd like to share one of my experience, and then I'll post one question. This is during my graduation days. I've shared it with sir as well. Like, we were practicing for a street play, and I was quite vocal about my caste, like two people, and because that was the reason, because I grew up in a Dalit community, so it is very much okay to like say jaydum to other person, because your neighbors or your relatives are Dalits actually, so there was nothing wrong in accepting the caste. But and many of my college friends also knew that I am a Dalit. But it doesn't mean that I'll go and tell everybody that I am a Dalit. But there is a thing that I am a Dalit. Okay, so I have never kept it away from anyone. But one fine day when we were practicing for that street play, the girl came from Dadar Shivaji Park. And if you know, on 6th of December, that was on the death anniversary of Ambedkar, huge people come over there. And that girl was again from a specific community, the higher class, higher caste, and she came up to me and she said, "Yes, tomorrow I won't be coming for the strip play practice, because I was the strip play head." So she asked me, so I just asked her that, "What is the reason why you're not coming tomorrow?" Because it just hit me, because there might be a reason. So she said, "We don't come out on 6th of December, come out of the house, because wo khatara log aa jate." So I said is it? So yes, she said yes. Well, she said so I just told her that I don't think so that you had a clue that I am one of the Khataras. You're sitting in front of me. Okay, and then she was like covering up that, okay, I didn't mean that, and I was like I got to know it. So as counter to ma'am, that it does exist, but earlier it was quite visible, now it is invisible. The people who are having the brooms in their hand, the same people are having the brooms in their hand, and the nepotism in this fraternity. But my question is, ma'am, that what would be like, how that safe space would be created? Like, even like people are talking, but we have to document it, right? So we have to make it quite institutional. So that is my question, that like, what would be that framework of being a safe space, according to you?
I think that's a very academic oriented question, but I can tell you in terms of journalism, because that's what I do. I think one of the safe spaces that we can create is, which is already happening in terms of Dalit-owned media, Dalit-owned channels, where we have the freedom to express who we are without judgment or bias or being told that we're not worthy or we're not good enough. So I think whether it's RTI, whether it's the camera that's going and documenting atrocities that nobody else would, or just our own Facebook pages, our own Twitter pages, or like this community that we have now known to call Dalit Twitter, that is also a safe space in terms of journalism, in terms of media. And I think what's needed more than that is also to create safe spaces in popular culture. Like, Dalit directors are already doing that. They are bringing Dalit stories to the forefront. And when we consume those narratives and those ideas are brought in the front and center, that itself does create a safe space. Because I think, I really do feel that popular culture, media, they shape opinions in a way that a lot of, that is quite consequential in how we think about Dalits, how we perceive Dalit people to be like. So just in terms of media specifically, Dalit safe spaces can be created and institutionalized with Dalit own media.
Maybe I could ask a query. Yeah. In your sharing now, you were mostly concentrating on the Dalit aspect of your identity and practically nothing about the woman part of it. Would like to say something about how it intersects.
I mentioned that in the book as well. Rajasthan is, and I don't want to go into this oppression Olympics, but it's highly patriarchal. In terms of, it's one of the highest states in the country where, the highest states for female feticide, female infanticide, discrimination with girl child. So in terms of my personal experience, I think one of the most hurtful experiences were that my mother had to fight with her own family to get me and my sister educated. And I know it doesn't seem like it right now, because you know I'm at Columbia, etc. But it was a long drawn struggle, especially being a Dalit woman, her being a Dalit woman, and the kind of not just discrimination but even violence within her own home that she had to endure from her in-laws, from her husband, because she wanted her daughters to have the same kind of opportunities and access to education that her son would. Because they were very happy for the son to go to a good school, go to college, and go to Delhi. Ajmer se Delhi jana hi bahut badi baat thi, mere liye. So my mother had to fight with it at every turn, and she led an extremely difficult life trying to give her daughters the same kind of opportunities that she would give to her son. And just in my experience as a Dalit woman, that is one formative experience that shaped my life and gave me, you know, told me what the world was like. What the world was like to be a woman who was hiding her caste. What the world was like to be a woman who was from Rajasthan and to be from a family that didn't want her to be educated or have the opportunities, or maybe at some level didn't even want her to be alive. It was a big deal that I was born, because Rajasthan is that kind of place, especially in the late 80s and early 90s. Girl children, when they were born, they were routinely murdered. Not killed, murdered. Like, you know, so the fact that I'm still here and in front of you and have written this book, I think a lot of it is owed to my mom. And the fact that she refused to step down, refused to listen, and refused to conform to what an idea for Dalit woman should be. And that's basically what my personal experience with patriarchy and patriarchy within our own homes also is like.
I have this small query, like considering Dalit as an identity and carrying forward this notion, and don't you think that it is like a vicious cycle and entanglement? Because having a low identity or a weak identity, or rather having a strong identity, it hampers the mind. This is what my research, so I am studying into identity. You know? So, because there is this quite a distinct between the social media of the ground, especially here in Maharashtra. They don't consider themselves as Dalits. There's this separate identity. And here the academia or the intellectuals, they claim themselves and they are quite assertive to be as Dalits. They have this separate identity known as Buddhist. They will, because here when they claim themselves as Buddhist, they are casteless, they have this free will, and they can think free without any barriers. And they consider themselves as equal to anyone. So, don't you think like Dalit is a, it is necessary, but as an assertive tool? Rather, what should be the optimum level of identity under the framework which is given by Baba Sahib then? Because ultimately, he has given that identity framework. So, how do you look at this paradox or the juxtaposition between these two groups?
Yeah, Yeah, no, if I'm understanding your question correctly, you're saying what are the limits of Dalit identity? That's
the yes.
Sense, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so let me just talk a little bit about how what Dalitness means in Maharashtra. And I've talked about this before, and what it means in Rajasthan, what it means in Uttar Pradesh, what it means in MP. And I think Dalitness looks different. Here, it's a really fortunate discussion to even be having. That hum itne dur aa gaye ki kya valuable bhi hai ya nahi academia mein bhi sarkon par bhi aap Rajasthan jaoge to you will see that wahan pe the discussion abhi shuru bhi nahi hua hai. So I think we have to understand the intersectionality of locations and how the identity is perceived there. It's a very valid and worthy discussion to have right now about what the limitations are, but we also have to consider those areas where this identity has not even been talked about. People haven't even started talking about it. There's a reason why my book got the attention it did, or my letter, or my coming out got the attention it did, because nobody knew that we Dalits were talking about ourselves in such a powerful way. And I when I say nobody, I mean mainstream media. You know, so I think in that, from that framework, it's essential to look at the different intersections of how this identity plays out in different areas. And people who do identify as Buddhists or are class or are casteless, I think it's a valid question for them to interrogate and understand what next. But for us, for people like me in particular, we're just starting out. And I think we need to go through that journey first before we can understand the limits. Our world has just begun. You know, the struggle has just begun for us. When we get there, I think an organic road ahead will probably emerge. But as of now, we've not even started.
Yeah. Ma'am, one of the High Court in Maharashtra, they told that they have not to use the word Dalit now, some of the case. And additional to one question of that professor, madam, she spoke about the college and all. As per my view, that in all the Dalit community, only the Buddhist community comes to know that they are from that category. Hence, because we show the identity of Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar. For example, we means हम लोग शर्माते नहीं हैं कि हम उस कास्ट के हैं करके. बाइक पे हमारे जय भीम लिखा होता है, घर के बाहर दरवाजे पे जय भीम.
उस कास्ट के मतलब किस कास्ट के?
Other than
yes sir. उस कास्ट के मतलब किस कास्ट के?
तो दलित म्हणजे सर्वात जास्त अकॉर्डिंग माय क्वेश्चन इज दैट सबसे ज्यादा अगर इफेक्ट डिस्क्रिमिनेशन होता है दलित कम्युनिटी के अंदर तो वो सबसे टारगेट पे बुद्धिस्ट ही होता है ऐसा मुझे लगता है. एंड बाकी राजस्थान यूपी ऑल ओवर इंडिया में अम्बेडकर एक मूवमेंट इज यूनाइटेड बट इन अवर महाराष्ट्र एससी कम्युनिटी के अंदर भी देयर आर नॉट डिफरेंट ग्रुप्स दे शो आवर खुद की आइडेंटिटी अलग होती है. दे डोंट इवन यूज फ्लैग ऑफ ब्लू कलर नाउ दे आर यूजिंग येलो रेड एंड व्हाइट ऑल रबिश थिंग्स एज आई सी. So what you think about that? Mostly this Buddhist people, they are targeted. So why we should use the term Dalit to us? Why can't we say, as my friend told, that we can say as Buddhist. In Buddhist there is no caste, casteless it is. So what is your point about it?
I just want to say, what's your name?
Vishal.
Vishal, I just want to say that I speak from the position of a journalist. I think these are questions about who gets to lead the movement, who gets to decide what a whole section of people are going to do. I don't think that's a question I'm equipped to answer or I ever want to be in a position to answer. And that's I think you're right. Should Buddhists be identifying as Dalit or not? But that's not my place. I am not the right person to ask that question because what can I tell you? I'm not Buddhist. You know, and
may I carry forward your question?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, but actually we are a bit confused. Like we see here the movements as Buddhist, okay, and the other castes who are also taking privileges of reservations and everything, but they still call themselves, they don't even call themselves, but they still be as a segment of Dalit community and be a part of Hinduism only. So Dalit as a word for us is becoming a threat nowadays.
I think we have a professor from sociology, he'll respond to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, in Maharashtra, in whichever forums we go, now this question is addressed. That itself is an honest admission of the way that we are, and we are courageous enough to face this question, and therefore it was bound to come up. Yeah, maybe I would start by my take on this. It plays both the sides. Okay, now my study is on Babasaheb's ideas of Buddhism. If you look at his writings, his most of his writings show Buddhism as a religion, if it is a religion, which is the best suited religion for modern democratic ideas. There is no mention of caste this is meant for this caste or emancipation or whatever. So he positions this as taking from John Dewey, his work The Common Faith. He positions this as the best suited form of religious ethic, which will lead us into a democratic political fabric. Okay, now that is the thing. But at the same time, in 1935, when he called the conference in Yavla, 32, that was of the Mahars. It was not of all category together. Maharvatan. It's important. Because at some point there was and it was also the mobilization, the Ambedkarite mobilization of the Jalsas in the 1930s also happened among the Mahars. Okay, and others joined, and we know the roundtable conference kind of politics which had this. So that fault line has always been there in Maharashtra. Now I would say when I did my field work in Ambedkar Nagar in Aurangabad, my collaborators were two Matang boys, and one boy was very articulate. His name is Chandrakant Kamble. Now Chandrakant Kamble told me in the course of our research, he said that Babasaheb Ambedkar made a mistake by converting to Buddhism, because when he converted to Buddhism, the Mahars co-opted him, so we don't feel part of it. You see, that's the other voice. You feel a particular feeling from this side, he feels from the other side. I met Laguji Sarve Vikas Parishad President Appa. I went to Appa's office, and Appa's office had, that time it was Vajpayee was Prime Minister, Vajpayee, Advani, the Sarsan Chalak, and Laguji Sarve, and Anabhav Sarve. I asked him, how do you reconcile with all of, and Babasaheb Ambedkar, reconcile with all of these pictures? He said, I'm an Ambedkarite at heart, but Mahars have co-opted Ambedkar, so I don't feel part of them. And today the RSS is giving my political formation that support, so I have all these pictures. And I don't see a contradiction in that. See, this is there in Maharashtra. So the yellow flag is there. The saffron flag is there. Sant Ravidas is there. Sant Gadge Baba is there. Babasaheb Ambedkar is there. So this is a fault line. Another quotation I can say is someone told me from another category, not Matan, not Charmakar, one of the DTND caste. He told me, our enemies are B and B. Do I have to say who is B? Buddhist and Brahmin. Okay, now this is a political fact. And this is, this has no answers. I would say something that has struck me in my readings of Babasaheb is that if Babasaheb was not a Mahar, Buddhism would have been accepted by across India by all castes. Because he was a Mahar, people typecast his religion as a Mahar religion. That is a feeling that I got upon my reading of Babasaheb. Because he is talking about universal principles, he's talking about Buddhism, he makes this distinction between religion of rules and religion of principles. What a theory. And then religion of principles as leading to democracy. And then we can see a connection with this, the speech he made at the parliament when he said, today we have political freedom but we do not have social freedom. And therefore we are starting a life. It is equally connected, because he had a vision of a social freedom which connects Buddhism and democracy. But you see, in Maharashtra, Buddhism got limited to the Mahar, probably because Babasaheb was a Mahar. Probably in the place of Babasaheb, it was Mahatma Gandhi who talked about Buddhism. A lot of Indians would have become Buddhist, I feel. So we are in this whirlpool of caste, whether we like it or not. And that is why I have it. That's my take on it. Okay, fine. Yeah. Any more questions?
There are a lot of questions on this.
I'm sure a lot of. If not, maybe then I can conclude. Maybe a few concluding comments. I got enough chance to talk because of that question. The first time I saw the title of the book, I liked it very much because it starts with coming out. Coming out is a word, as we know, it is, mostly used by people who come out as gay. That imagery, I'm using that imagery to Dalitness and coming out as Dalit is something that is that shows that parallel, the connectedness of both of these experiences, which itself is intersectional. So the title of the book itself is intersectional to me in that level, and it shows the multiple kind of experience of stigma and owning it up, and the connections between all of that is something that gets reflected in that. The category of Dalit, again, there is no specific definition to it. It's about how you define it, how you own it up, and all of that. Then the idea of the denial of caste. The idea of the denial of caste is like, there are one section of people who deny caste because they have the social capital of being of a particular higher position in caste, and therefore they can afford to deny caste. Like, for example, I remember this M.S.S. Pandian's commentary on M.S. Srinivas. When M.S. Srinivas commented on his field work, and he said, I happen to live in the Brahmin quarters. I could have as well lived in the Dalit quarters, but you know, there are issues of hygiene and things like that. So M.S.S. Pandian coined this word about caste by other means. We don't name caste, but caste is practiced by other means, and one of which is merit, the other is hygiene, and there could be any number of caste by other means. So there is a way in which certain sectors of the people who can afford to deny caste because they are of a higher level. But they talk and practice caste by other means, by never naming it. And then there is the other side, people for whom caste is a stigma. They could also deny caste. In the public, like, you know, people don't straight ask you, aapka jaat kaunsa hai. My experience is people have another neutral word, you know what it is? Samaj. It's not jaat anymore. Aapka samaj kaunsa hai. People have asked me, aapka samaj kaunsa hai. Now the thing is like, in Maharashtra, in Mumbai, it's okay with me. I would say I'm a Syrian Christian. Nobody would understand what it is. it's okay. So they wouldn't know where to locate me. Once two of us were in a, we took a lift from Mangav to Mumbai, and the other guy who was with me was a Charmakar, and I was there, and so they started making conversations, and they wanted to size us up and ask me, aapka samaj kaun sa hai? But I said, I'm a Syrian Christian. They just kept quiet. They didn't know who I was. The other guy asked, aapka samaj kaun sa hai? Charmaka samaj ka. So the entire tone of the conversation changes after this admission. The way that the kind of things that they were talking, see, they were actually talking about Raj Thackeray and, you know, how great he is and all of that. So that don't change, you know, when he said that he is a Charmakar. So this is about, so who denies caste? A section of the people can afford to deny caste, and others would deny caste because of stigma associated with that. And both are denying caste, and both have their own reasons for denying caste. And Yashika Dutt today has shared with us the context and the courage in which she has come out as a caste, and thereby what I was touched by her admission is, narration is that when she talked about the acceptance she felt after coming out as Dalit, and that acceptance, that Biradari as we call. And also, like, I would like to tie it up with one of the questions I don't know who asked us about, how do we take it forward, and how do we make a platform? When we look at the platform, it is also important to include allies in the Dalit platform. there are many allies. There are people who are Dalit allies. And there are allies of all identities, like allies of gays or allies of blacks. So it's a platform of Dalits who want themselves as Dalits and who identify themselves as Dalits, and also the allies. And that's the public platform which will be built powerfully to challenge the ignominy of caste in our country. So these are some of my stray thoughts on this. Thank you. And thank you, Jessica, for this.
अरे शिकलेला आहात ना
Thank you very much.
Especially for the lively discussion and very important questions. Yeah?